From the place we read, he tells us about Jesus and his crucifixion. I don't want to bore us with what transpired, but I want to lay a foundation. Probably the man who was also a criminal, who was crucified alongside with Jesus, the one who ran on Jesus, who abused Jesus, he said something that is very fundamental. He said, if you are Christ, it's not that he doesn't know that he is Christ. It's not that he has not heard of his miraculous deed. It's not that he has no witness of how people have mocked him. He has experienced, he has had, he has lived, for he lived in the time of Jesus. He knew he was a thief. He knew he was an armed robber. He knew he was very wicked. He knew he was selfish. He knew he was a sinner. Yet, beside him stood salvation in person. And look at what he said. He said, if you are the Christ, save yourself and also save us. I don't know why this message is coming now. The social media has been awash with so much criticism. Some have said, where are the prophets? Some have said, where are the pastors? Some have said, let them prophesy. Why didn't they prophesy to us that coronavirus is coming? Some have even begun to abuse pastors. Let's see how they will survive. Now that there is lockdown everywhere, let's see how they will survive. Armed robbers, thieves, all they are looking for is for the offering. My good friend, even if you do not give offering, the church will still stand. Even if all of us begin to walk with life, the church will still stand. The major concern of the gospel is not what you bring. The major concern of the gospel is the salvation of your soul. That statement, that criticism, that is, it reminds me of what this thief is saying. Instead of him to face the consequences of his action and man up to own responsibility for his sin and find a way to solve his soul's problem, rather, what did he say? Oh, Jesus, look at you. They call you the King of the Jews. You allow them to crucify you. If you say you are Christ, why don't you save yourself and save us too? That's the most inhuman thing I've ever had people say. No man wants to suffer. We always want to shift blame. But the principles of God standard sure, it does not change. The Bible says that any soul that sinned shall die. That is the condemnation that faces every sinner, whether you are dead or alive. But there is a hope of salvation. That is why Christ came. The Bible says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, so that whoever believes is a matter of choice. It's a matter of choice. It doesn't matter where. It doesn't matter where you meet Christ. You can meet Christ at the point of death. You can meet Christ in the midst of suffering. You can meet Christ in the midst of plenty. It is what you do with the realization that salvation is at your beck and call that matters. The Bible says that armed robber, that thief that was being crucified alongside with Jesus, the one beside him, begin to rail on him, begin to accuse him, begin to say a lot of evil about him. Look at you. That is mocking. That is a man refusing to understand the mysteries of the kingdom. We're in a dire situation now in this world where salvation is so, so important to us. Let me even give us a background about what happened. Now look at this. I've always wondered, why did the priest, why did the leaders of the temple and the synagogue, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, insist that Christ be crucified? If you go to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 21, then you find out that when God was giving laws to the Israelites, he made certain things. And he said, when a man commits a crime that is worthy of death, and he is hanged on a tree, say his body should not be allowed to stay there till daybreak. He must be brought down. He said, because he that is hanged on the tree is accursed of God. So to them, there was a rationale behind crucifying Jesus on the cross. The reason is simple. If you crucify him on the cross, all his popularities, all the people believing in him, we say that he's a cost of God. They forgot that even before his coming, it has been said in the book of Numbers by Moses when God revealed it to him. As the serpent is lifted up, so shall the Son of Man be lifted up. They never knew that their orchestration, their evil conspiracy was bringing Jesus into fulfillment of the scripture. Yet in their little mind, crucifying Christ will paint him not as a Messiah. All of us knows better. Probably that is the same thing that would have prompted Adam Robert to speak in the manner he spoke. People find pleasure these days in castigating what Christ stands for. People find pleasure in these days in refusing to accept sin and embrace salvation. I have been mandated to come and bring it to your knowledge that salvation is just beside you. The good news of God is beside you. It is the will of God that you prosper. Not just, but even as your soul prospered. The prosperity of your soul and the peace that comes with it is most important to God as far as you are concerned. Now look at what the other man said to him. The other armed robber, the other thief, the other sinner said to him, "Do you not fear God? Is it that you have not heard about God? Is it that you have not heard about what Christ has done? Is it that you do not know, you do not believe? If you do not believe, my prayer is that God will help your unbelief." There is salvation. There is salvation. The good news is that there is salvation in the midst of crisis. There is salvation in the midst of pain. There is salvation in the midst of problems. That is the good news God wants me to give to you this morning. Now look at this. The man beside him made a statement of faith. He said to him, "Do you not fear God? Is it that you do not know that this man standing beside us or in our midst is innocent of what he has been accused of? But you and I, we know ourselves. We are armed robbers. We are liars. We are fornicators. We are adulterers. We are cheats. We are backbiters. We are sinners. We are prostitutes. We do a lot of evil. We sit down and we plan evil. So why do you condemn this man, even though he has been in the same condemnation with us?" You see, that statement reflected three things. And that is what is very important in salvation. Number one, self-realization of that we are sinners. The Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Self-realizing, accepting your responsibility, number one, that you are a sinner. Look at what that man says. "Do you not fear God? We are sinners. I am a thief. I am receiving in equal measure the consequences of my actions." Number two, even in the midst of the cross, as the man was hanging on the cross, he did something that was reflective. He never condemned his executors. He never laid blame on the judge who pronounced judgment on you. He never laid blame on the man who reported you to the police. He never laid blame on the world for persecuting him. He said, "I am guilty of what I did. I accept the consequences of my action." He didn't begin to excuse himself like the other man. He didn't begin to find justification for his sins. No matter how you justify your sins, sin is sin. And it has one consequences and one escape route. And what is the escape route? Repent. That is the escape route. No matter how you paint it, the three things this man did earned him salvation and straight access to heaven. And what are those three things? Self-realization that I'm a sinner. Accepting your mistake. Knowing that this is wrong. I have done it. How do I make up? How do I come out from it without going back? Then he confessed with his mouth the Lordship of Jesus. That is the thought. He confessed. How did he confess? "Oh Lord, you don't call a man who you don't accept his sovereignty and authority as a Lord. You don't call a man who you don't accept his supremacy over your life, oh Lord." It's an indication, it's a symbol of submission from the man. Say, "Oh Lord, when thy kingdom will come." He recognizes, he has heard, he knew He has seen the things that has happened around Jesus. And he made that confession of submission. Oh Lord. Oh Lord. Remember me in thy paradise. And Jesus looked at him. Oh, what a wonderful confession. You see, there is an aura of salvation all around the world. There's an aura of good news all around the world. Irrespective of the crisis we are facing, salvation still stands. If you can open your mouth like the man at that cross of Calvary standing beside Jesus who said, oh Lord, remember me in thy paradise. Jesus said, if you confess your sin, that is faithful and just to forgive. His desire for us is that we prosper. He said, the devil go about like a roaring lion seeking for whom to devour. He said, but for me, I have come so that you will have life. Not just have life. You have it more in abundance. Abundantly. Abundance of life. Salvation brings peace of mind. Salvation is a big relief to a sinner. When you confess your sin, it's as if a body has been lifted up your shoulders. He said, if you confess your sin, he said, I am faithful. He said, he is faithful and just to forgive. He is faithful and just. Some have always said, my sin is so big, can God ever forgive me? Some have said, I have killed people, I have murdered, I have committed crimes. I have done a lot of evil. I have poisoned people. I have done a lot. Say, can God forgive me? Let me shock you. The Bible says, come, let us reason together. He said, come, it's an invitation. Come, let us dialogue. He said, even if your sin is as black as scarlet, say, you should come. It doesn't matter whether you are in prison. Say, I am beside you. If you seek me, you will find me. If you ask of me, you will find me. I am just standing beside you. Wherever you are, I am there. My spirit is there. Just a little prayer. Come, let us reason together. Say, even if your sin is as black as scarlet, I'll make it as white as snow. If it's as red as crimson, I'll make it as wool. What is it that is drawing you back? Will you accept the lordship of Jesus and say to him, oh Lord, remember me in thy paradise? Will you accept like the man, when the man looked at Jesus, he was not seeing a colleague in condemnation. He was seeing the opportunity for salvation. When the man looked at Jesus standing, the two of them were seeing the same thing. The two of them were experiencing the same thing. The one thief standing by the right, the other one standing by Jesus in their middle. They saw a crown of thorn upon his head. In their presence, his side was pierced, and water and blood came out. In their presence, he was given a soured vinegar and a soured wine. It was poured upon him. In their presence, they had this thing. They saw it. They saw his sufferings for our sake. Yet, the one by the other side did not see salvation. He saw excuses. He saw transfer of blame. He saw an opportunity to make others carry his burden of sin. But the other one, no. He saw an opportunity for an everlasting salvation. Everlasting salvation that will save him from the consequences of damnation of sin. That is why when he looked at Jesus, he was not seeing a colleague criminal who was crucified with him. He was seeing salvation standing beside him. When you look at Jesus and when you open your scripture, when you read about him, you hear about him, what do you see? When we talk to you about the salvation that Jesus has brought, the good news and the salvation of your soul, what do you see? Do you just see Christ as other people tell you as a story? Or do you see him as an excuse in this time of crisis? If Christ exists, why don't he come and save us? Now you are something similar to the man who does not have understanding. Who lost the opportunity for salvation. The other man in the midst of pain, the same crucifixion, the same nail that was pierced was also pierced in his hand. Yet he knew there was a difference between him and the man beside him. And he knew that Jesus had the capacity to save. He saw salvation and he took it. That same salvation is what I'm bringing to you on a platter of gold. It is free, you don't pay for it. There is no special procedure for it. All you need is to believe. Do you believe that Christ has capacity to save you? Do you believe that Jesus can save you? The cry for salvation is very real. No matter the sin you have committed, even at the Golgotha there is salvation. Even at the Calvary there is salvation. So I send this invite to you. Accept Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior. He has capacity to save you. He can wash you with his blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary. He will sanctify and purify your souls. He will make you wonderful. He will welcome you. The kingdom of God is so vast. He needs more soul children. As many as believe, he has given them power to become the children of God. I desire that you become one of the children of God. I desire that you become one of the sons of God. I desire that you become one of the daughters of God. I don't know how what you are doing. I don't know what, where you are. You are listening to this message. I want to pray with you. If you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, I encourage you to do. You can make this prayer with me. Oh Lord, I am a sinner. I ask for your forgiveness. I give my heart to you as my Lord and personal Savior. Cleanse me from all my unrighteousness. Make me one of your children. Remove my name from the book of death and put it in the book of life. I desire to live for you and you alone. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. God loves you. He loves you so much. Even while we were yet sinners, he first of all loved us. And I know that God has a reason for this message to have come now. And as I pray that he bears fruit in your life, may God continue to bless every of your endeavors. Whatever you lay your hands upon shall prosper. Thank you.